Okay, let's get started. We have only an hour and a half, and this is a topic which has been in the news for a variety of reasons in the last several weeks, if not months. And in the center of this exercise has been Dr. Vidyadhar Pathak. He's not a stranger to the community, IIT community, or the Mumbai community. He's been member of many of our committees on campus. He was a keynote speaker at the inaugural of CUs about a year and a half ago. So he's familiar to most of us. And yesterday when I called him up to ask if we should go ahead with the program, thinking that he might be away from the phone for obvious reasons and all that, he very quickly said, I want to be there. So that shows what his passion is for this topic. And he had three topics to talk about: open spaces, array, and FSI. So he's going to take FSI and array mill colony problems or planning, and depending on how much time there is, we'll do the others. I think you want to take questions along the way, or you want to wait until you finish? Okay. So we'll see how it goes, and we'll take after, unless there's a burning question which needs his answer right away, we'll wait for the each presentation to be over and then take questions. Okay? So without further ado, Dr. Pathak. And thank you all for coming. I think if we had the DP going, we may have had more people, but now people probably have gone back to thinking that it's not going to happen.
It must have been canceled.
Right. So we'll do another talk a little later, closer to the deadline.
Thank you, Professor Ramamrutam. He called me doctor, but I'm not a doctor. But I'm always ready to accept honorary PhDs. So what I'm going to do is to first describe what the DP is. Because a lot of anxiety and criticism comes out of not appreciating what the DP is all about. So I think that is the first thing I intend to do. And then I have three presentations. But depending upon the time and the interest, we can probably will be able to do two of them. The three presentations are, one is about RA. What is the proposal about RA in the DP? What is the FSI issue? And the third is, what is the issue of open spaces in Mumbai? Of course, there are many other issues, but all of them cannot be covered in a short period of time. The first question is, what is development? Now, as we would understand, development is a much bigger concept. It might include economic growth that is inclusive. It might include human development, which then encompasses education, health, and such other facilities. It also includes the notion of environmentally sustainable development. And then you can add many more things to that whole concept of development. This development is not about that development. That should be first understood. The development is defined in the Town Planning Act, and that development is in a way a physical manifestation of all these activities, which is essentially in terms of land use, in terms of building and engineering activities, and a variety of other things. Demolition is also called development in the definition, because it's one of the engineering operations which has those things. Reclamation of land is development. And all these developments are supposed to be planned and monitored through the process of development plan. That is that development plan is. Only in Maharashtra and Gujarat it is called development plan, borrowing the British connotation. But all other states in India purely call it as master plan. So they are better understood. You know, Delhi is a master plan. So it is understood as a land use and physical plan.
Is DCR not included in the?
Yes. I'll come to that. What is the content of that? So it is essentially a spatial plan or a physical land use plan. And what does it include? It includes the planning for land use. It includes planning for intensity of development, which is essentially the FSI densities, etc., etc. It also includes the development control regulations. And first of all, it also includes the a way in which land has to be procured for public purposes. Now, be that roads, other infrastructure, schools, hospitals, what have you. And then whatever is remaining in terms of land, how that should be controlled in terms of development. So that those are those DCRs and development control. So in a way, DP divides the city land into two realms, the public realm and the private realm. And then it has a set of regulations to manage what happens in the private realm. DP is not a comprehensive, holistic, integrated plan. And these three words are very popular. Every planner wants to have his plans to be this, but these are the hollow words. You know, they don't mean anything. And DP is not a holistic, integrated, comprehensive plan. So it is essentially a land use, physical, et cetera, as described. Interestingly, I think that is a notion, because I think I'm trying to sort of wear both caps, you know, a practitioner as well as some academic interest. This is an academic issue, that whether we can really attempt holistic, integrated, comprehensive planning. Our education is not attuned to doing this. A land use planner and a transportation planner cannot talk to each other. They have different languages, they have different processes, they have different theories. And though they always call, you know, land use transport integrated plan, it's very difficult to achieve this. Leave aside all other considerations. The governing structure is not suited for this kind of thing. The way within the municipal corporation, the departments don't talk to each other. In the inaugural speech, I mentioned tree, and they really function as tree because the last end of the branches can't talk to each other. They have to go through the branches and the main trunk. Then only they can communicate with each other. That is how our structures are. So they don't lend to comprehensive planning. What we have there for, I think those of you have seen the report, that report is in three parts. Part one talks about what is the existing situation. Part two talks about what the vision and the goals could be. And the part three really talks about what the proposals are. And the part three begins by saying that this is a broad framework, plan in the nature of a framework, within which many pursuits could be possible. So it's not attempting to do everything, but it is trying to say that you can still pursue many of those goals within the broad framework of the plan. And therefore, it mentions what are the various types of sectoral plans that need to be prepared in a more or less continuous fashion, and not as a 20-year plan. This is essentially a 20-year plan. But those sectoral plans can be more in terms of 5 to 10-year plans backed up by investment programs. This plan has no investment. It has a broad estimation of cost, but it's not like a project where you know exactly how much of money during what period you must spend. This is not this plan. So there you need those kind of other plans. And those also need to be done as a part of a more continuing exercise. So that has been emphasized. May I have some water? So what are the contents of this DP then? I indicated the structure in three parts. there is a land use zoning, which is commonly understood, you know, where what kind of activities are possible in which part of the area. Here we have tried to deviate from the conventional ways of doing zoning. In the previous plan, within residential, there were two types, R1, R2. Within commercial, there were C1, C2. There were I1, I2, I3 in industries. There was no development zone. And then there were real no development. You know, there was no development and real no development. National park was probably real no development. We can have a look at that, what that was. So what we have done is, because Mumbai is essentially a mixed zone city, unlike Delhi, Delhi has a very strict, or had a very strict land use zoning. You might have read the cases where the courts came down heavily on the shops in residential areas and sealed those shops, because they were not permitted in residential areas according to the plan. And then the government had to bring in an ordinance to allow those shops to continue in the residential zone. Now, Mumbai never attempted that kind of land use zoning, and nor is it very desirable. So in the new plan, we have essentially three zones. One is called RC, which is residential dominant, but commercial also possible. And there is CR, which is commercial dominant, but residential is also possible. And the third one is industrial. Now, these industrial are really big industrial areas, like BRC and those kind of, or refineries. So those kind of really large areas are called as industrial zones. And the existing industrial areas, but they are permitted to be converted. If an industry wants to close down and convert itself into some residential or commercial activity, that is also permissible. And the fourth is the natural areas. Now, in these natural areas, no development is permissible. That includes the national park and the mangroves, or what are called CRZ1. So those are essentially the natural areas. So there are only four land use zones, much more simplified if you compare to the previous plan. I think a lot of emphasis in the new plan is simplification and not creating complex regulatory framework, because complex regulatory framework has been one of the problems in Mumbai for the development. And what kind of that we will come to when we have the presentations. The other major issue is how to procure land for public purposes. In the previous plan, a large number of activities were identified as activities for public purposes. And the implication of showing them as for public purposes is that once you have done that, you have to acquire those compulsorily. And if you don't want to pay monetary compensation, there was an option of providing transferable development rights. So either you pay money or you pay the transferable development rights. And many such lands were put under reservation, which have never been used. Never been acquired. In fact, there is a case of IIT. There is, at the other end, there is a 10-hectare piece of land which was never acquired. And now that person has served a notice on IIT in that either you release it from designation as land for IIT or pay me the compensation for that. Now, IIT is saying we have no money to pay for compensation. Naturally, I think he is going to get that land released, because you can't endlessly keep somebody's land under public purpose reservation without paying compensation and not allowing him to develop. So in this plan, what we have done, we have tried to, first of all, rationalize the list of activities for which we really designate land as public purposes. And that is a very minimum and flexible list. For example, in the past, for the BEST, there were three or four types of designations for public purpose. Bus depot plus housing, and bus depot plus bus station plus housing, something like that. So if it is only bus depot, no housing could be built. Unless you go to government, make the whole process of this thing. Now we have tried to simplify those things. Plus there were things like public purpose reservations put on the existing developed properties.
For example, the four cotton textile markets, Murji Jetha, Swadeshi, Mangaldas, etc., etc. On those markets, a open space reservation was put, which was not, never going to be really possible. So we have removed those kind of things. On the Juhu airport, there was a reservation of a park. Now that park was never going to be realized. So that has also been removed. It is recognized as a airport or transport infrastructure airport. So those kind of rationalization has been done in case of deciding what is really required for public purposes. In that process, the previous plan had aspired to provide 6 square meters per person in the island, in the suburbs, and 2 square meters per person in the island city. And after so many years of implementation or non-implementation of the plan, the real open space is only 1 square meter per person. So in this plan, what we have said that it's not possible to attain that 6 square meter, etc. So we will attain only about 2 square meters per person. So that's a very realistic possible way of doing things. Now this has become a big controversy, and if we have time, I'll show you what the implications of those are. The third is how do you monitor and measure the intensity of development, and that is FSI. And FSI has also become a very controversial issue, and I think I'll rely more on the presentation which is devoted to FSI. What we have been practicing in the past, and also in Maharashtra particularly, is to do a very detailed development plan for the next 20 years. First of all, assuming that the planner knows what is going to happen 20 years hereafter, which nobody really knows. But unless you assume that, you know, planner assumes that I know what is going to happen in 20 years, he can't do a detailed plan, where the school should be, where a maternity home should be, where a library should be. In 10 years, what library is, the whole notion of library will change. And that is not really known. So what we have attempted to do here is that this DP is essentially very broad brush DP for the entire city, but it will be followed by what we have called as second tier plans or local area plans. Now, Delhi does it that way. Delhi has a master plan followed by zonal plans. Or Ahmedabad has a DP followed by town planning scheme. So we have also recommended in this, though there is no such practice in vogue in Maharashtra, that the DP should be followed by local area plans or tier 2 plans. And what we have done some kind of costing in today's prices for implementation of this development plan, and also indicated what are the measures for raising finances to do this. Even though the measures are so strong that they can do many times the cost of development plan, but that could be used for other infrastructure as well. Very distinguishing feature of the plan, which has not been noticed by most people, is the monitoring and evaluation. The most city plans or the development plans are characterized by total absence of monitoring and evaluation. Nobody watches how the city is growing. If you go to BMC and ask them in Ward X how much of floor space was built last year and for what purposes, you won't get an answer. You are not asking how many slums, no? You are asking what is the building activity permitted, formally permitted by the BMC. Because the notion of converting basic data into information for decision making is absent. And it's absent particularly for plan purposes, because these plans are done for the plan's sake. You know, the plan is there. You know, there are no protocols for how to implement those plans. Therefore, there is no monitoring, you know, how much. So that is why now people are asking as suggestion and objections, first tell us how the plan was previous plan was implemented, though it is already covered in the report. But then you have to do that exercise 20 years after the plan is prepared. Now, how much of that was implemented?
So we have strongly recommended, whether that will be implemented, one has to see, is the requirement of monitoring and evaluation. And we have essentially recommended that four things should be monitored.
Because we have also put in one of the goals that Mumbai will have to become a competitive city if it has to continue to prosper. Because other cities will begin to compete with Mumbai, whether it's Bangalore, Hyderabad, Chennai, or even other cities. So Mumbai will have to reinvent itself in terms of new activities, new economic growth, etc. And its competitive index has to be monitored. And there are many agencies which are doing this intercity comparisons in terms of quality of life index, in terms of real estate market prices, in terms of ease of doing business. But all those things have to be compiled and brought to notice for the decision making with respect to development of Mumbai. The remaining three are what is the economy and real estate of Mumbai? Mumbai's economy in terms of GDP is measured, but its GDP as a gross. The composition of GDP is not, at least in public domain. So you do not know which sectors of Mumbai are growing faster. If manufacturing is lagging, whether it's retail that is growing faster, whether it is IT is growing faster, or financial services are growing faster, that kind of things are not available. So one can attempt that that is also brought into the monitoring process. And the real estate. How is real estate operating? Whether the total quantum of floor space that is built in Mumbai has a secular trend of growth, or whether it keeps on fluctuating with market cycles. It's by common reading and observing in newspapers, one gets a feeling that Mumbai's real estate is becoming cyclical. It's not a continuous growth. And what these cycles are and how do they operate? That kind of information is not available. Then the last two ones are, of course, mundane in the sense continuously measuring how much of development plan is getting implemented every year and what are the financial resources that are deployed to do this implementation. So you have a track going on in terms of what's happening. And then we are saying that every 5 years, you should take a stock of those things and if required, change the plan. Because plan is not based on complete knowledge of future. Of course, nobody can have that complete knowledge. And it is also not a prescriptive plan. I'll come to that, you know, what I mean by prescriptive plan. So that needs monitoring and adjustment more frequently because things are changing faster than they used to. So therefore, you can't have a fixed 20-year plan and hope that everything will follow in the same lines. What I mentioned in terms of prescriptive, I think I must caution that this plan, town plan, is not a design. It's not an architectural or engineering design. You know, once architect designs a building and he tells the contractor this is how it should be done, then that is how it shall be done. So it's more in the nature as thou shalt. Plan is not like that. Plan is creating a framework which allows many things to operate and go ahead. So unfortunately or fortunately, most planners come from architectural and engineering background. And therefore, they again, there is a mismatch in terms of conception that in the plan or the master plan or development plan, you are not creating a design which has to be implemented. You are creating a framework in which many forces, many activities, many sectors have to contribute and develop the city. So that understanding again is important. Okay, that is in terms of background of what the development plan is. If there are questions, I can take them, few of them, and then move to presentation.
And therefore, how much crucial information is actually expected to be open.
I'll describe that. The first exercise was to carry out an existing land use plan. And this existing land use plan was placed on the DMC's website, displayed on in the boards, etc. So many people had a look at that, and many of them brought out inaccuracies in the plan also. In Mumbai, there are something like 1,27,000 land parcels. And people pointed out inaccuracies in case of 5,000 land parcels. And out of that, the real inaccuracies were in 500 land parcels. So those have been corrected. So that is the first step in terms of telling people what is being done. The second was what was called preparatory studies. And this document was also released in public domain. And on the basis of this document, many thematic workshops were held. It was presented in large gathering, and then many NGOs offered to conduct thematic workshops on each of those. So a number of such workshops were conducted, and many recommendations or suggestions came in. Again, the expectation was that everything that was recommended must find a place in DP. Now that is not possible. I'll give you a simple example. That the slum dwellers said that on our slum there is a reservation of a garden and we live in that area, and the redevelopment is not possible because that garden cannot be removed. You know, the imposition of a garden cannot be removed. The friends of trees, open space enthusiasts, they said, no, nothing of this should be done. All garden and open space reservations must be maintained. Now the planners have to choose one of them, you can't have both. And that happens in many cases. Plus, of course, there are many things which are not within the scope of development plan. So those also have to remain peripheral. So they have not been important. And once the plan was done, the plan partly has to be a little bit of secret because you are affecting individual properties. You can't be very participatory at the last end of the planning process because you are going to say this open land is going to be for open space or garden or something. Now if you start telling that fellow, can I put a garden on your place or you do I put something else, you know? That's not going to be helpful. So it has to be done in one shot. And now it is open for people that it's a report, which is 500 page document. It's a development control regulation, that is another 200, 300 page document. And there are two sets of plan. Each set having 168 or 65 sheets. And one set is about the proposed land use, which gives you the land use zoning and the areas designated or reserved for public purpose. And the second set tells you what the FSI is going for each parcel. Now even the parcel numbers, everything, it goes down to the parcel numbers. You can see your survey number on the map and understand how much can be, or what can be done. If the plot is small, you can't see that, so you have to use a magnifying glass. So that is how
this data could have been given in digital form.
It is available on the website.
No, it is available. It's not the right thing. What I'm saying is, PDF files.
CDs are also available.
No, PDF files of images is not something that I can really do any questioning. Why can't we have some shape?
That is coming up. I think they have announced, but it's not yet in full form. So you can go to that and put your suggestion or questions right on the site. So you have that. But wave-enabled, what you are saying is wave-enabled GIS should be used. I think that's the next
step. Desktop-enabled will do, if it's not wave-enabled, because that will be too weak. But desktop-enabled, if board-wise could be shared, then it becomes far more open.
See, that risk is there. Right? If somebody tampers your file, then what will you do? So that is why they have gone more cautiously with PDF files, but if we have adequate sort of protection, etc. Somebody can fit it with your files, and then you have. There are already those kind of problems.
You had mentioned about competitiveness of cities. Along with that, I think the document also talks about inclusiveness and sustainability.
Yes, yes.
I think before we get into details, sir, could you elaborate on these?
See, actually, these three goals are underlying goals for almost all of the entire developmental process is underpinning of these three things. You know, it's a competitive economic growth, inclusive growth, and the environmental system. Now, what the development plan could do about this is that you create a framework where the real estate also starts operating competitively, which has therefore some price advantage in terms of competitiveness, which today Mumbai doesn't have. Mumbai, in fact, has priced itself out. And at one stage in the last couple of years, of course, the real estate prices in terms of office rentals has gone down. But at one stage, Mumbai's real estate office rentals were almost competing with those of New York. Only London and Tokyo were higher than Mumbai. So Mumbai was virtually pricing it out in terms of prices and also in terms of, so Mumbai was trying to sell very low quality urban at a very high price. And that is not being very competitive. So the development plan is trying to address those in a limited sense, that you have a development permission process which reduces transaction time and cost. It allows FSI regime, which allows market to operate more competitively, and therefore the prices could become competitive. There is a direct provision for inclusionary housing in the provision. So every private development will have to provide for inclusionary housing provision. So that is towards inclusiveness. And it has also included in the development control regulation a separate section on regulations for helping the physically challenged in the buildings. So that is one element of being inclusiveness towards the physically challenged. And there is a set of environmental regulations which are also separately done, which are not very great or great innovation, but whatever has been there has been put together, like the rainwater harvesting, use of solar energy for water heating, grey water harvesting, grey water recycling. Those sort of things have been put together as a part of the development control regulation. So those are the more modest efforts towards those three goals that could be.
Okay.
Yes.
So in the beginning you mentioned that the development plan is more about land use and building construction mainly. But in the DP you have also covered some infrastructure issues like, you know, water supply, drainage, waste management, and things like that. But one thing I found missing was the energy component. Is there any reason why the energy, and especially looking at the environmental sustainability point of view, the energy was sort of missing, that component was missing in the
part of the reason is even water, sewage, sanitation have been mentioned by way of information. They have not been directly addressed by the development plan. Whatever is currently being done by the municipal corporation has been summarized and mentioned there. Mainly to say that enough is lined up for water so that the 14 million projected population can be provided with water. But it's not a plan that does the water. And energy is not covered because even if you cover that, the decision making is not within the realm of who implement the development plan. It's neither with BMC nor with the Urban Development Department of the state. So I think my personal experience is that you can write anything in the plan, but if it is not within the governance structure, nothing gets done. You know, in the regional plan which we did in 96, we had put in that the free housing for slum dwellers and the free being made by loading the cost on the new home buyers is not a financially sustainable model, and that should not be the case. Urban Development Department approved the report, but the Housing Department didn't care to look at that. So I think there are limitations in terms of what you do given the governance. Could we move to presentation? I'll do the RA first, which is a short one, and then we can go here.
opportunity. It's not a thing that has to be done. But if you are looking at future, then that is, there lies one opportunity. That is how it has been. So it can cater basically to emerging new economic activities, and particularly where the economy is going to move from manufacturing to services to knowledge. You know, that seems to be the path of growth. So therefore we need to have some institutions of excellence and other things. And what can we do for that? If we look at the history that in the pre-independence era, you had Ballard Estate and Fort area developing for financial services of that era, as well as some professional services, etc. And the land was essentially publicly owned. You know, Ballard Estate is owned by Fort, and the Fort was owned in a way through the improvement trust. In the 60s and 70s, you had Bagmi Reclamation, which was essentially catering to the new corporate sector activities coming up in Mumbai. Then in the 90s and 2000, you moved the focus to Bandra Kurla complex, where it was essentially for the new emerging financial services. And what is interesting about Bandra Kurla is it was initially conceived in 1973 for the purposes of decongesting Fort area. And the first idea was that the textile markets, Mulji Jetha, etc., should be moved to Bandra Kurla complex. And in fact, the plans were done, some civil work was also started, but nothing happened. And in post-91 period, when it was realized that the financial services are going to have a spurt, it was changed to cater to the growing financial services. Again, the importance is that Bandra Kurla was essentially a government-owned land. So in these kind of cycles of economic growth and change, the experience shows that the publicly owned land becomes very critical, because privately owned land is looking at quick things which are easily done. You know, malls can be done on private land. But if you want to develop a new financial district, then you have to plan and use public land for those kind of purposes. Therefore, in future, if Mumbai is hoping to capture the new opportunities for economic growth, the opportunity lies only in RA area, because that is a large publicly owned land. There are many examples how opportunities have been lost in the past. This Indian School of Business went to Hyderabad, Indian School of IIHS, Indian Institute of Human Settlement went to Bangalore. There is no urban planning. I mean, CUs is there, but there is no sort of Institute of Urban Studies in Mumbai. You know, Mumbai is one of the most complex cities in the world, and there is no dedicated institution which devotes to looking at urban issues. So there is a problem in terms of providing for institutional growth in Mumbai, and whether city wants to use RA for that purpose. You know, those are the questions and the directions to opportunities. Similarly, what has been planned here is that major cultural and open space facilities having area more than 8 hectares, and how are they distributed? Most of them are in the island city. As compared to that, the suburbs don't have, and now suburbs have something like 3 times the island city's population. So if you look at RA's context, then it is well located. There are roads and other connectivity between east and the west, and the RA is situated right in the middle. JVLR is there, and there is a planned Goregaon Mulund link road also, this dotted line there. There is a, this road exists, but that could be also used, that passes through RA Colony. And the metro is going to terminate in RA. Now that itself has become very controversial, but if that metro has to terminate there, that is one more opportunity, because you have a metro station making the area accessible to entire South Bombay. So area that is currently available is about 1,000 hectares. Out of that, industrial use is 1.5%. And the rest of the area is largely vacant. There is 4% residential development as well. This is, of course, the terrain and other characteristics of the area. Now, people are saying that this is a no development zone. Now, one has to look at what is permissible in the no development zone as of now. This is the list of activities which are permissible in the no development zone. So it's not a real no development zone. So if you can have amusement park and golf courses there, if that is what you want. So retaining is a no development zone is not a solution if you really want to preserve it as a biodiversity sensitive area of Mumbai. And because of this, there are a lot of small pockets which have been diverted for a variety of uses without being noticed in a way. So all these areas, now this is the area which is already used, the lower blue corner. Royal Palms are located within original R area. Film City is within original R area. IGDIR is also in the R area. And on the periphery, you are also having a lot of slums coming up. So all these orange pockets are these slums. So in a way, RA needs to be what the commissioner used the word, needs to be hard-coded in terms of land use. And not just call it as no development zone and leave it to future in terms of what happens there. So what has been proposed? Roads will take away about 10% of that 1,000 hectare area. Open spaces will 61%, all these green areas which are shown here. 9% is institutional, that red area. 4% for rehabilitation of slums, etc., which are within RA. And these pockets, which are there are two of these pockets, one near the terminal and one near the Western Expressway, together accounting for 9%.